Welcome to the Blue Ridge Baptist Church YouTube channel. It's brought to you by the folks here at Blue Ridge Baptist Church, and we pray you receive a special blessing while spending the time here with us. And to God be the glory.
Page number 514. Let's stand together and sing. 514. Good to see you this morning. We are grateful for the Lord taking and allowing us to come into His house today. Brother West, would you lead us in our prayer? Amen. All right, you may be seated. Come on, brother, and lead us on.
You'll turn to 634. 634, My Country, 'Tis of Thee. 634.
Mountain.
singing that song ever since we was in school. I don't know if they sing it a whole lot in school now. But that song right there is a tremendous song. Did you hear the words as you sang them? What a tremendous, my country 'tis of thee, sweet land of liberty, of thee I sing. Land where my fathers died, land of the pilgrim's pride. From every mountainside let freedom ring. I was watching this last week, a news broadcast, and on that broadcast they interviewed a number of people on the streets and asked them what they thought about the 4th of July and how they were going to celebrate it. And I was hurt deeply in my soul because not but one out of all the crowd that they interviewed had any concept about what freedom meant in our country. And they didn't celebrate it. They weren't proud of it. They weren't thrilled about being an American. And so I was hurt in my heart. This song right here reminds me of the things that we have in America. And we're celebrating America. We're going to do that around here. We're going to celebrate America. I am glad I'm an American. Now, you could have been an Ethiopian if you wanted to be, but that's not what God made you. And you could have been over yonder in Europe somewhere. That's not what God made you. God made us Americans. If you don't like it, leave it. That's my sentiments about it. And so I'm thankful for America. Did you see that verse? Verse 3 said, let music swell the breeze. I'm glad it didn't say rap society, aren't you? Listen, we have degenerated so much in the music realm. Yeah. Rap ain't music, neither is rock and roll. You're welcome. Thank God. Let music swell the breeze and ring with all the trees. Sweet freedom song. Let mortal tongues awake and let all that breathe partake. Let rocks their silence break. Sound prolong. My, what tremendous truths those things hold for us. Well, it's good to be here. I'm glad you're here. I don't want to get started preaching before it's time to preach. And I look around and I miss several folks. It look kind of like it's kind of shy around here. But at any rate, we've got plenty to eat back here. And we're going to take and eat in just a little while and enjoy the fellowship. Enough of you hang around. We'll sing a little bit this afternoon. Enjoy the fellowship some more. There will not be any church tonight here. There will not be any church here tonight. Some of you wanted to visit other places or with your family. Take this opportunity to do that. Or if you're going to stay to the house, take the opportunity to just rest and enjoy your family at the house. But we want to say thank the Lord for how good he is to us and take this afternoon in fellowship and enjoy one another. It's good to be here this morning. Pray that God will take and help our hearts and draw our hearts closer to him. All right? All right, let's go ahead and have the morning offering then. And we'll take that in. Good to be here. It's good to be here this morning. Thank God. Amen, Brother Owen. You got here just in time for the offering. Hallelujah. That's a blessing. Amen. Yeah, we started just a few minutes early, and that's all right because we have an extra song or two. Okay? Good. Brother Paul, lead us as we pray. sister, y'all ready? Listen. All right, Sister Gail, come ahead on. Praise God.
So this song is not patriotic, but it is God reverencing and fearing, I guess. It's just an old favorite, The Promise. That sound guy, you know. I'll tell you. Next year we should double his pay, just like the piano player. Shiver in the cold, but I did say you'd never walk through this world alone. And I did say, don't make this world your home. I never said that fear wouldn't find you in the night, or the loneliness was something you'd never have to fight. But I did say I'd be right there by your side. And I did say I'll always help you to fight. You know I in every time of need, my love will be the anchor that you can hold on to. This is the promise, this is the promise I've made to you. I never said that friends would never turn their backs on you, or that the world around you wouldn't see you as a fool. But I did say, like me, you'd surely be despised. And I did say, my ways confound the wise. I didn't say you'd never taste the bitter kiss of death, or have to walk through chilly Jordan to enter into rest. But I did say I'd be waiting right on the other side. And I did say I'll dry every tear you cry. But you know I've made a promise that I've prepared a place, and someday sooner than you think, you'll see me face to face. And you'll sing with the angels and a countless multitude. This is the promise, this is the promise I've made. Thank you. those promises that are new every morning.
So just keep on walking, don't turn to the left or right. And in the midst of darkness, let this be your light. That hell can't separate us, and you're gonna make it through. This is the promise. This is the promise I've made. This is the promise I've made to you.
All right, it's certainly good to have a promise, isn't it? All the promises of God are yea and amen in Him. And it's good to see you this morning. Thank God. Anybody have a word of testimony they'd like to give this morning? It'd be a good morning to give it. All right. God done something special for you this week. Anyone? You know, you try to give a little extra time here and there. You know, things like that. All right. All right, you have your Bibles. Let's turn now. I want to confess this morning. I'm going to read several passages of scriptures. Some of them I'll stay pretty close to. Some of them I'm going to linger a long way from. But the essence of what I want to try to talk about this morning, I want to read you just one passage over in the book of Hebrews. And I won't get back to it for a while, but I'll get back to it later, all right? And you can just kind of keep it in the back of your mind. And if you will, maybe it'll be of help to us sooner or later. Hebrews chapter 11, verse number 13. These all died in faith, having not received the promise, but having seen them afar off, were persuaded of them, embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. Now I want you to get this word in your mind. He said, they seek a country. Now I realize that this morning, we are celebrating to a great degree the Declaration of Independence, our Day of Independence. And we thank the Lord for this day. And so I do want to make reference to how good the Lord's been to our country. And I am patriotic and make no apologies for that. And thankful for God allowing me to be an American citizen. And I appreciate the Lord for that. Let me read a couple of more verses, though, and say a few words about them this morning. Over here in the book of Psalms, in verse number 9, or chapter number 9, verse 14, I believe it is, Psalm chapter number 9, down verse 17. The Bible said in verse 17, the wicked shall be turned into hell, and all nations that forget God. Now that's a pretty inclusive type verse right there. Very clear. There is no doubt about the destiny of the wicked, and there is no doubt about the nation that forgets God. Over here in the book of Proverbs, there's another verse that I'd like to just bring to your attention. Proverbs chapter 14, verse 34. The Bible says, righteousness exalteth a nation, but sin is a reproach to any people. Now, certainly that is true. I don't think there has to be a great amount of deliberation over a verse like that. It is true that when the righteous are in authority, that thank God you have a peaceful dwelling. It's a blessing, and I bless the Lord for that. Righteousness does exalt a nation, and it is true that sin, when it's allowed to go unchecked, certainly it is a reproach to any people. And then another verse in the New Testament I'd like to just read in passing. Over here in the book of 1 Timothy chapter number 2, there in verse number 1 and 2, listen to this verse. I exhort therefore, first of all, supplications, prayers, intercession, and giving of thanks be made for all men, for kings, and for all that are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceful, I thank the Lord for that, life in all godliness and honesty. I want to speak to you for a few moments this morning on America, and I have several scattered remarks. So if you feel like, well, you know, Brother Ralph might could get his thoughts together a little better, I probably could, but I probably leave some of them out. So I want to just speak about America and a few things about it this morning. You know, repeat itself? I've often wondered about that, and I've of course said it is. History, of course, does not repeat itself in the exact manner as it did. It doesn't repeat itself in the details as it did, but certainly on a broad sense and in dealing with broad principles, it's true that it does to some degree repeat itself. And let me, for instance, give you an example or two. We talk about sometimes authorities. There are authorities that have studied such as this, and they've come up with some kind of a cycle that's been recommended by them. And in past civilizations, those that have rose and those that have certainly fallen, they said this is the cycle. Now, I don't know that it is a valid cycle, but I can see if it is, that we must fit somewhere in it. It says of this cycle, it says men go from bondage to spiritual faith, from spiritual faith to courage, from courage to liberty, from liberty to advariances, from advariance to selfishness, from selfishness to complacency, from complacency to apathy, from apathy to despondency, and from despondency back to bondage. Now, if that is a valid cycle that historians give to us, I wonder where America would be in this cycle. There are several problems worldwide that have never completely been dealt with. There are, in all nations, things have to be dealt with, but they just never are completely dealt with. For instance, all nations have to deal with the matter of government. No matter what nation it is, somebody has got to govern. Then again, all nations have to deal with economics. What is the best way to provide for those that are governed? Then all nations have to deal with lawlessness. Now, it would be wonderful if there had to be no law, but there is a law, and we have to have laws. They're good. Then again, the matter of peace.
one of the confrontations worldwide is this constant warfare. Kingdoms have always risen against kingdom. And there has been chaos in higher powers everywhere. The world can't seem to find peace. Again, racial hatred. That is an issue that is worldwide. And we're not only experiencing it here, but they've experienced it all over the world. Religious unity. That is another issue that is a problem throughout all nations. Then again, we have to deal with the perplexity of sickness and disease. Despite our hospitals, despite our doctors, and despite the modern medicines, these kind of things are still having to be dealt with. Now, there are three reasons I think that America has been blessed of the Lord. And I think that God has taken and certainly helped us in America and been good to us. America is still in the world today. And I think for three reasons. One, I think because that we've been a blessing to the Jewish people. God said a long time ago, those that bless thee, I'll bless them. Talking to Abraham. And America has been a blessing to Israel. Then again, it's because of America that evangelistic fingers have went out through the world. I think because of our evangelistic movement through the world, God has blessed America. I picked up an article today talking about Dr. Lee Robinson and Tennessee Temple, and literally thousands and thousands of missionaries have been sent from Tennessee Temple in years gone by. Thousands of churches have been started across the world because of Dr. Lee Robinson's effort in that direction. Same way with Jerry Falwell, and same way with a number of other men that God has raised across the country. But America has been blessed because of her evangelistic thrust in the world. Then I think thirdly, America has been blessed because it's America who is the balance of power in the nations of the world. If it were not for America, we'd all be slanty-eyed this morning. If it were not for America, we'd be in debt to Moscow this morning, paying homage towards Russia this morning. And so would the rest of the world. I realize, dear friend, that there are some things we may not need to be in, but we do need, and I'm not saying we're the policemen of the world, but I am saying we have been used by God to balance the powers of wicked realms across this world. And so thank God for America. God has blessed America. I believe as far as I can say in my own heart, one of my favorite songs is America the Beautiful, because it expresses in my heart the very fact that I believe there's no other country in this world like America. Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountains, majesty above the fruited plain. America, America, God shed his grace on thee. Crown thy good with brotherhood from sea to shining sea. I believe in America, and America has been blessed of God. I realize that in the making of this nation, it was God and God's grace and God's guidance that has taken and produced the country you're living in right now. It was God that directed this thing into fruition. And I bless the Lord for America, built upon principle. Principle. Dear friend, the principles of freedom and of moral righteousness and sacrifice and self-control, those are the things that dictated the principles of America and our society. Now, of course, I know we've perhaps lost our moorings, but dear friend, these things were so in the early foundings of our country. Built upon principles, built upon prayer, prayer, dear friend, that were offered by the men of our and our leaders, presidents, and prayer that was offered by people. Prayer from the farmhouse to the factory. People depended upon and looked towards God to move in their life and in our country. God made this nation strong because He made the people dependent upon Him and them to be strong in faith and in practice. Again, the country, the making of our nation, lies in the fact that we practice common decency across our country. I know there's been some uprivals in different places. I know there's been abuse in some places. But dear friend, for the most part, there was a common decency that was practiced throughout our country. And dear friend, God made America great because of it. I was thinking of how a nation could be marred. You know, God said over in Isaiah chapter number 3 that He would mar a nation. How did God mar a nation? Well, a nation forgets God. A nation turns its back on God, forsakes God. And brother, I want to say there's a generation coming on the scene now that doesn't know anything about God. They've hewn out cisterns, broken cisterns that can hold no water. And in Isaiah chapter number 5, God takes away some things. And brother, God has took away some precious things from us. And God's given some things. God's given some tyrants over us. And I want to say to you, God has allowed our nation to be marred by sin. But thank God there is a mending of the nation. And God calls us together and says, come, reason with me. Now I want to say to you, it's better to be clean than it is to be filthy. Can I have an amen right there? It's better to be forgiven than be guilty and condemned. It's better to be willing and obedient than to be rebellious and disobedient. It's better to walk in love and be loved, dear friend, than to be hated and to be resented. I want to say to you, God has made our nation. Our nation's been marred by sin, but that doesn't have to be the end of the story. Now I want to talk about this morning, this idea of making a nation. I was thinking about, you know, we've heard a lot of things that's wrong with America. And I'll probably get on some of them in just a minute. But I want to say there's some things that's right about America. And I'm appreciative for those things that are right about America. I know we've got a lot of negativism going on, but dear friend, there's some positive things in America. Let me say just a word about why I'm proud I'm American and thankful that I'm an American. I thank God that I'm an American because of our Christian heritage. We have a Christian heritage. This thing did not start off in the back closet or a back room or down a back alley street. Dear friend, we've got a Christian heritage. We were founded in liberty, and we have a constitution that is decorated with the kiss of God upon it. And thank God for America. You know, I realize that there's been a lot of facts in history that's been erased from our books, and we've perhaps not got them on our mind all the time. But I picked up here a while back some of these facts that have been erased out of the history books, and people know little about them. We hold these truths to be self-evident. I think that's a wonderful thing. Here's some facts you might need to know. Did you know that 52 of the 55 signers of the Declaration of Independence were Orthodox, deeply committed Christians, and the other 3 believed the Bible as the divine truth of God and God's scripture and His personal intervention in life? Did you know, dear friend, that that same Congress that wrote the Constitution of the United States and the Declaration of Independence, that same Congress founded the American Bible Society immediately after creating the Declaration of Independence? Did you realize that it was that same Continental Congress that voted to purchase and import 20,000 copies of Scripture for the people of our nation to begin with? Do you realize that Patrick Henry Now I was thinking about old Patrick Henry. He's called the firebrand of American Revolution. And he's still remembered by those words, give me liberty or give me death. But in our current textbooks, that's about all you read about him. What about the other words, the context of those words? Listen to what it says. Here is what he actually said. He actually said, an appeal to the arms and the God of hosts is all that is left us. But we shall not fight our battle alone. There is a just God that presides over the destiny of nations. The battle, sir, is not to the strong alone. Is life so dear or peace so sweet as to be purchased at the price of chains and slavery? God forbid, Almighty God forbid. I know not what course others may take, but as for me, give me liberty or give me death. Sound like somebody wanting to depend upon God and lead God, or be led by God in our nation. Now these sentences have been erased, and our young folks don't know so much about these from their textbooks. It was Patrick Henry, a Christian. Somebody said, was he a Christian? The following year, 1776, he wrote this. It cannot be emphasized too strongly or too often that this great nation was founded not by religionists, but by Christians, not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. For that reason alone, people of other faiths have been afforded freedom of worship here. That was Patrick Henry that said that. Consider these words. You know, we have a lot to say sometime about Thomas Jefferson and hear a lot about Thomas Jefferson. But Thomas Jefferson wrote on the front of his well-worn Bible, I am a real Christian. That is to say, I am a disciple of the doctrines of Jesus Christ. I have little doubt that our whole country will soon be rallied to the unity of the Creator. He was also the chairman of the American Bible Society, and he considered that his highest and most important role in life. January the 4th, 1821, President Adams said the highest glory of the American Revolution was this. It connected in one indivisible bond the principles of civil government with the principles of Christianity. Calvin Coolidge, our 30th president of the United States, affirmed that this truth when he wrote this, the foundations of our society and our government rest so much on the teachings of the Bible that it would be difficult to support them if faith in these teachings would cease to be practically universally applied in our country. In 1782, the United States Congress voted this resolution. The Congress of the United States recommends and approves the Holy Bible for use in all schools. Boy, we've come a long way, haven't we? I'm talking about how we started off in this thing. There was some Christian influence in our country. William Holmes McGuffey. How many of you have heard of the McGuffey Reader? The McGuffey Reader, the author of the McGuffey Reader. It was used for over 100 years in our public schools, and over 125 million copies sold until they were stopped in 1963. President Lincoln called Mr. McGuffey the schoolmaster of the nation. Listen to these words of Mr. McGuffey. The Christian religion is the religion of our country. From it are derived our notions on the character of God, on the great moral government of the universe, governor of the universe. On its doctrines are founded the peculiarities of our free institutions. From no source has the author drawn more conspicuously than from the sacred scriptures. For all these extracts from the Bible, I make no apology. of the first 108 universities founded in America, 106 of these institutions were Christian. In fact, Harvard University, chartered in 1636, in the original Harvard University student handbook, rule number one was that students seeking entrance must know Latin and Greek so that they could study the scriptures. Let every student be plainly instructed, earnestly pressed to consider well the main end of his life and studies is to know God and Jesus Christ, which is eternal life, and therefore to lay Jesus Christ as the foundation for our children to follow the moral principles of the Ten Commandments. James Madison, the primary author of the Constitution of the United States, said this: "We have staked the whole future of our new nation not upon the power of government, far from it. We have staked the future of all our political constitutions upon the capacity of each of ourselves to govern ourselves according to the moral principles of the Ten Commandments." I want to say to you, our country has had a tremendous influence, Christian influence. This is not a fly-by-night situation. I thank God for our Christian heritage. We live in a country of God-given plenty. We do have plenty. Thank God for the beauties of the land and for the bounties of the land. God has shed His grace on America. And I thank God so very much for it. I think about our children's opportunities. Now I realize that in this day and this time, you know, when children are given everything, but there was a time when they were not given everything. And dear friend, in America, and only in America, can a man rise from the poorhouse and go all the way to be a leader in our country. America's like that. America, there's an opportunity in education. I know education is not so much a good topic in our day and our time, but dear friend, the very fact that you don't have to be dumb and your young'uns don't have to be dumb is an amazing thing to me. 700 million people in this world cannot read, and you and your young'uns can read. What a real blessing that is. I think about the opportunity to live in a family situation and be able to train our children up in the way that they ought to go. I think about pursuing God's will. And then again, for the children to be able to enjoy their childhood. Did you know we're not bound to those little slave farms that children are bound to in other countries? I thank God for America. It is a God-given plenty land. It is a children's opportunities that are afforded us to go forward in life. I think about America, and I'm blessed. And one of the reasons I love America is because of the family ties. I'm glad I've got a family. I appreciate my family and my heritage as a Coleman. But dear friend, I want to say to you, not every country has the kind of ties that we've had and we've experienced. I know that this generation has a hard time. I realize that men have taken and thrown responsibility out the window, and women have taken and lived in a loose fashion, and they care not about what goes on today. But when I was a boy, I knew my mama and I knew my daddy. I knew my granddaddy and grandma. I knew my aunts and my uncles, and they'd gather around. In fact, yesterday, I got a piece of mail yesterday. From the Porch Indian people. And Roberta McGee Sales is who used to tell stories to the Indian children back some years ago. And they put one of her stories in a little booklet form, and they sent me a copy of it. And I opened it up and I looked. Of course, my little old brain's kind of small anyhow. But as I was looking at that book, And I showed it to Sister Ann, and you got the story in Indian language on one page and then in English on the other page, all the way through there like that. And while I was looking at the book, my heart got tugged, because I could remember as a little boy, back years ago, we'd sit around and we'd listen to those grown-ups tell stories about this and about that and about the other. We wasn't so much involved in a TV. We didn't have one for a long time, you know. But we listened to them tell stories. Oh, listen, I'm glad we have a heritage in our country like that. Family ties. I've appreciated my brothers and my sisters as they've looked after my mother in my absence. I'm so thankful for family ties. America affords us that. You could have been born in a country where you could have been sold as a baby, carted off and not known your mom and your daddy. And I realize the media projects a different kind of America. But dear friend, families still get together in America. And I love America for it. I was thinking about this this morning. You know, we think about America and we always think about our liberties. And I realize that there's been a lot of propaganda that's faced us and has been forced upon us. But dear friend, many nations do not have the liberty that you have this morning. We're enjoying being in the house of God. Why? Because somebody afforded us that liberty, and I thank God for it. I bless the Lord. I think about our part in evangelism. I know that God could have written His message in the skies. Dear friend, could have formed it with the clouds. God could have written it across the top of the mountain. I realize that God could have written it on every blade of grass. But dear friend, God chose men to evangelize this world. And God raised up America. And America has sent more people and spent more money to evangelize this world than any other country. Oh, thank God for America. I realize to whom much is given, much is required. But dear friend, I'm glad to be an American this morning. Now, how do we keep these blessings that God has given us? There's a scripture over here in the Old Testament that we've referred to on a number of occasions, and I'm sure it'll be referred to a number more occasions over here in the book of 2 Chronicles. Listen to what he said to Israel. If my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive their sin and will heal their land. How do we keep the blessings of God upon us as an American? Dear friend, by remembering God. I read the verse to you. Psalms 9 verse 17. The wicked shall be turned into hell, and all nations that forget God. We need to remember God. I picked up a prayer by Billy Graham. Let me read the prayer to you. I wish I could have prayed it, and I do pray it with him. Billy Graham, Heavenly Father, we come before you today to ask your forgiveness, to seek your direction, guidance. We know your word says, woe unto those that call evil good. But that's exactly what we've done. We've lost our spiritual equilibrium. We've reversed our values. We've exploited the poor and called it a lottery. We've rewarded laziness and called it welfare. We've killed our unborn and called it choice. We've shot abortionists and called it justifiable. We have neglected to discipline our children and called it building self-esteem. We have abused power and called it politics. We have coveted our neighbor's possessions and called it ambition. We have polluted the air with profanity and pornography and called it freedom of expression. We have ridiculed the time-honored values of our forefathers and have called it enlightenment. Search us, O God, know our hearts, cleanse us from our sin, set us free. And I say to you, dear precious friend, if my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves, I will say that's exactly what we need to do in order to keep the blessings of God. He's our source of freedom. If the Son sets you free, then you're free indeed. He's the fountainhead of our blessings. Dear friend, Nebuchadnezzar finally learned it wasn't him. It was God, dear friend, that caused people to rise up and people to fall down and kingdoms to rise and kingdoms to fall. God has his way in the armies of heaven and upon the earth. It's Christ who is the hope for the future, not only the hope for America. We need to remember God, and we need to walk righteously. I mean righteously. Dear friend, the righteousness exalteth the nation. Sin's reproach to any people. How is it to walk righteously? Well, it means to walk honest in your business. Has there ever been a time we need to be honest in business? Sure there is. And America, dear friend, needs to be called back to those markers of honesty in business, cleanness of morals. Our morals need some cleaning up. If the Holy Ghost would take the spiritual wash rag of the Word of God and wash up our morals, what a wonderful blessing that would be. Most people are immoral. Not all moral, they're immoral. Rather than truth being present and truth being paramount, dear friend, we need our morals cleaned up. Devout in religion. Devout in religion. You know, the idea that you can just pin on Jesus and take him off when you want to, that's sickening in the nostrils of God. The idea that you can just be Christian on Sunday and live like the devil the rest of the week, that's not Christian at all. The idea you can come and go like you want to and choose your own way, that has nothing to do with God. Dear friend, we're looking for some devout people to love God and walk with God and live for God and God to be the center of their life. I'm talking about walking righteously and then praying faithfully. Over there in 1 Timothy, I said that supplication should be made for all men, especially for those that are ruling over you. Why? So that we can live a quiet and peaceful life. Now, I know you don't believe this, all right? But I like it boring. I really do. Somebody says, what's going on? I said, nothing. Hallelujah. Huh? I like it boring. I like for there to be peace on earth. I really do. I like peace around my house. I like peace with my neighbors. I like peace at the church house. I'm not looking to fuss and fight. Amen. You're welcome. That ain't that I can't do it. I just don't like it. Are y'all like that? Some of y'all like to run and no, I'm not like that at all. I like it boring. Suits the far out of me. Hallelujah. Bells and whistles don't thrill me anymore. I like it to where I can just... He said prayer ought to be made for all men, especially them of authority, so that you can live a quiet and peaceful life. You know why most folks like activity? So they can hide. So they can hide. I mean, you hide in confusion. Well, that was a good point. I need to bounce on that again, I reckon. To remember God, walk righteously, pray faithfully. That'll prolong the blessings of God upon our America. God would have spared Sodom and Gomorrah if he could have found 10 that would have just walked with him, just talked. 10 righteous. What happens if we don't? Well, what happens if we don't is that God's wrath falls. His wrath falls. God takes away his hand of blessing upon us and his grace is withdrawn from us. And that's worse than any tragedy or any calamity that you can imagine. You do realize that God controls the nations, don't you? You realize that God controls the elements, don't you? And that God controls the bounty of a nation, don't you? And God controls the liberties of a nation. And you take and neglect them, you take and neglect God, you'll lose it all. His bounty, His blessings, His grace, His presence, you'll lose it all. Now, I read a scripture to you this morning in Hebrews chapter 11. Hebrews chapter 11 said that they seek a country. I believe that could apply or describe our pilgrim forefathers and the founders of our country. They came from over there seeking a country over here. Don't you think that could be said of them? They were looking for something they didn't have over there. They came looking for something they found over here. They seek a country. I think secondly, it could describe the political powers that are in our government right now. They're seeking a country, but it's not our country. Corrupt, cunning, conniving men and women are seeking to change America into some other type of a country. The values and the views and the virtues of our country are being exploited and taken away. These wicked people are destroying her foundations, erasing her heritage, extinguishing her dreams, changing her freedoms, dishonoring her flag, crippling her constitution, silencing the voice of justice, stifling her individualism, capping her industrial superiority, crippling her military, relinquishing all of her liberties, cause the majestic majesty, they're casting it to the wind. They're laying her grace and goodness and her greatness in the gutter. Wicked men, wicked women, they're not serving our country or seeking our country. They're seeking to make this another country. That's what's going on. But then I think that this verse could apply and does apply to the child of God seeking another country and a better country. Let me say this, and I don't want to be, and I realize that some can misconstrue this, but as the country goes, so goes the church. Bible said that certain men crept in unawares, ungodly men. And Jude and 2 Peter and 2 Timothy describe them. And it says that they bring in their damnable doctrines. Certainly that has happened in our country. Wicked men and women have slipped in and they bring in all their damnable doctrines. True, isn't that right? My little thought about folks moving in down here. Keep all your devilish doctrines over yonder. Don't bring your politics in here. They deny the truth. People have come into the church and deny the very truth that we believe, this Bible. People have crept into our country and have denied the truth that's been put down in the Constitution of our United States. This display against the justices of our world, of our country. What a terrible display that is. As the country goes, the church will go. Now, I'd say the church has fallen upon bad days because the country's fallen upon bad days. Damnable doctrines crept in, denial of the truth. They do despite to the spirit of grace. They dishonor the Lord Jesus. They desecrate the church, the house of God. All these things are going on in the church world, but they're going on in the country. And it's because they're going on in the country, dear friend, that it's happening. They advocate social tolerance in the name of universal harmony and peace. The brotherhood of all men in the quest for a global economic unity of all nations. They say doctrine doesn't matter. Just believe, you know. Believe what? Believe what? For the child of God, we believe the Bible. If the Bible's not so, then friend, we're out in the cold. It makes a difference what you believe. We don't believe it's right to stand out in the streets and protest and demand rights to kill little babies. We don't believe that. Do we believe that? No, we don't believe that, Brother Ralph. No, we think it's wholesale murder. That's what we believe it is. What a sadness it is for people to, and then to take the very heartthrob of your society, your laws, and be so desecrating towards them. What an awful thing that is. Burn our flags. Cause an expression of freedom. I think they ought to hang flag burners. You're welcome. Somebody said, that's our right and that's our freedom. No, it's not your freedom. If it's your freedom, go to Russia and do it in Russia. I'll tell you what, dear friend, you burn a Russian flag, they'll hang you. They ought to do some of that around here. It stops some of that junk. Somebody said, oh, Brother Ralph, that's so mean. I don't want to be mean. I don't want to be ugly. But I love America. And if you don't love it, leave it. That's what I believe that with all my heart. If you don't love it, leave it. I mean, we'll buy you a ticket, and if we won't do it, I'll do it. Just one way, you're gone. I don't have no use for that. No use for somebody that doesn't love America. Somebody says America's racist. America is the most race-free country in the world. Red or yellow, black and white. If you've got a will to work and you got a want to and a desire, you can do something in America. It's not like that everywhere in the country. Say amen right there. Amen, Brother. I'm on this. Christians are looking for another country. That's my point. My point is this. Never before has the child of God felt so homesick. I'm getting homesick, aren't you? I've got to where I feel out of place in this world. And I'm constantly reminding myself that we're not home yet. It'll change after a while. But home's not too far away. I think sometimes I can see it just around the bend. I can almost catch the lights of it just right over there. They look for a country. I go a little step farther. There's a city to which we're moving, whose builder and maker is God. One of these days, thank God, and I love America. I appreciate America. America's been good to me. I couldn't imagine being anywhere else. I have been a few other places, but I ain't never been nowhere like America. Friend, one of these days, we're going to set our tent up the last time. Take it down the last time. And we're going home. Some call it heaven. I call it home. But I love America. And I hope you do too. If you're here and you don't know the Lord, you can't appreciate what God's done for you and allowing you to live here like you ought to. You need to know the Lord. If you're lost and without God, it's only the redeeming blood of Jesus Christ
that can save your never dying soul. Put something on the inside of you that makes you want to go to heaven. Cause you to fall in love with everything there and out of love with everything here. Put in you a purpose for living. Sin's forgiven. Peace moves in that heart. That's the portion of a person who comes to know Christ. I want to recommend him to you. It's not a fly-by-night deal. It's a permanent change because it's an operation of God in that heart. Hallelujah. Let's stand together. Well, hold just a second before we stand. Let's go ahead and have a word of prayer. And we'll pray for each other. And, you know, might be somebody here that does want to receive the Lord. Maybe it'd be a good time to do that. So let's just bow our heads for prayer. And if this morning you're here and you're lost, and you know you're lost. By the way, if you find out you're lost, it's not because you just found it out. God's already whispered it to your heart somewhere else. And he's brought you into this place to confirm his message to your heart. It's not, he didn't just start working with you. He's been working with you. And you can be a rebel against God if you want to. And you can die and you can perish without God. Or you can submit to the Lord and ask him to save your never dying soul, forgive you of your sin, trust Jesus. You can do that and he'll save you. He will save you. He said, he that cometh unto me, I will in no wise cast out if you'll come to him. I ain't talking about joining a church. I'm talking about coming to Christ. If you're not a member of a church, you ought to be. But I'm talking about you ought to be saved before anything in this world. Our heads are bowed and eyes are closed. Sister's going to play just a verse of an invitation hymn. And if you need to come, you get up where you are and you come. Brother Ralph, aren't you going to have all the church stand up? No, just you. It's you and Christ. Would you want to come to Christ this morning? Would you dare to stand up and find your way to an altar and ask Jesus to save your soul? I want to invite you to come if you want to come.
Thank you for spending the time with us at the Blue Ridge Baptist Church YouTube channel. And while you're here, please select from our playlist previous messages from both our pastor, Brother Ralph Coleman, and many other preachers and evangelists. So avail yourself of these ministers of the gospel and share with friends and family, and I know you will both find and be a blessing. And as always, from here at Blue Ridge Baptist Church, to God be the glory.